If you've been a longtime Democrat in New Hampshire, you know the name McEachern. Paul McEachern was twice the party's nominee for governor in the 1980s, and now there's a new generation on the political scene. Deglan McEachern is joining us here today, running for Congress in the 1st Congressional District as a Democrat. Thanks for being here.
Adam, thanks for having me here. Being in WMUR, sitting in this studio, it's an amazing honor and treat for me. You know, we grew up, MUR and politics go hand in hand, and so, you know, certainly in our household, this was always tuned in for
awesome.
the coverage.
Thanks for the plug. You were one of the last Democrats to jump into this race. This field is already epic in size, but when you were looking at it, what made you say, looking at that field of Democrats, I can do this and I can win?
Yeah, so growing up in Portsmouth, you know, I love New Hampshire. I live right across the street from the house that my dad grew up in and my grandfather built, and I just saw there wasn't enough people talking about the pain that New Hampshire is feeling right now. We have low unemployment, but we don't have great jobs. There is just not a lot of opportunity for people. And I can relate to, you know, trying to make ends meet in that sense. August 4th, 2014, my wife got ill. She woke up and told me she couldn't feel her arms or her legs, and we had to go to the hospital and figure that out. And that took about 2 years to do. And all the while, we're trying to figure out, how are we going to pay for this? How are we going to afford rent, credit cards, health insurance? And it's that pain and that anxiety that we went through that I don't want anybody else to have to go through, certainly in America, but especially here in New Hampshire, where I know that's happening. And I didn't see anybody talking about that, and certainly not with the passion that I bring to this issue.
Did you have health insurance through that period?
We had health insurance, and that's the biggest thing. You know, you can have great health insurance in this country and still not afford to be able to cover all of the expenses, the deductibles, the total out-of-pocket expenditures. This is the reality in America, that we have health insurance. It's a right, but it's not affordable. And that's really the question that many Americans, and certainly people in New Hampshire, are facing. How are they going to pay for it, even if they get sick, with great health insurance?
The system we have now is designed essentially under President Obama. What changes would you propose to so-called Obamacare to make it work better?
So I would propose a single-payer, a Medicare for all type system. Right now we have rental car health insurance. You shouldn't have to figure out how you're going to pay for something just because you get sick. It shouldn't all be going on credit cards. We need to have a system that understands that right now you're on insurance for 3 to 5 years. It could be because you change jobs. It could be because you change either your company changes plans, or you just go in and out of affording it. We need a system that's looking holistically at your health care and being able to provide that in a way that's going to lower costs, because right now costs are just continuing to rise.
The president just put a $60 billion tariff on Chinese goods. You work in the tech sector, I mean, you're probably well aware of what China does with our patents and a lot of things. There's a tremendous amount of theft that goes on, outright theft. Is this a good idea? And from your perspective in tech, is this something that people you work with say, yeah, right on, let's hit the Chinese back for this?
No. They do not. Nobody that I'm talking with is saying that we should go after the Chinese. And I think the stock market is kind of indicating, you know, where the market views this trade war. I don't think we can have a trade war. What I want to see is a focus on building industries here in America. You know, talking about tech, building that industry and allowing people to really have an opportunity in this country. We just don't have that. You graduate high school and it's the only option you have is college. You know, we need to make sure that high school is good enough so you could graduate, you can afford to buy a house, afford to start a family in the town that you grew up in. And we're not there right now anymore.
The president on Friday tweeted out that he's thinking about vetoing the spending bill that Democrats and Republicans just worked together to create. We've spoken to members of the delegation, at least their staff right now are kind of out of their minds that this could happen after all of this work being done. They would argue that at every turn, the president seems to be choosing the most chaotic option. Now, one of your counterparts in this first CD race has already come out and said, let's impeach Donald Trump. That wall has been broken now. Are you there with Lincoln Soldati saying, you know what, before I even get elected, we're going to send this guy out of office?
So Donald Trump and President Trump, he certainly doesn't set a great example for my daughter. He certainly doesn't set a great example in terms of how he personally carries himself for anybody, I believe, in this country. And I look forward to the day when we have a different president. But unlike Donald Trump, I believe that there is a constitution put in place to follow, and this process needs to be followed in order to make sure that we're able to protect our democracy. You know, I respect anybody who wants to say, you know, get him out of there, but I think it's more important to have this process and really respect the Constitution, and I trust in Mueller. I think that he's doing a good job. I don't even think this is going to be an issue when we get into to Congress. I think we're going to find out, and following this investigation, what he's able to uncover, and I trust in that process.
So on the seacoast, one of the big issues is drinking water contamination from perfluorochemicals. If you're elected, what steps are you going to be taking to ensure that that's cleaned up, and perhaps people who've lost children to cancer or get restitution, any of those things? What would you propose?
Yeah, so I was really encouraged with Senator Shaheen in the budget being able to really pull all this money into the first study of this sort in the country. I think we need to study it. I also think we need to clean it up because, you know, you have kids, I have kids. It's the last thing that you want to think is that you're going to be somehow putting them in danger just by them being on this planet. And I think if we can't have safety in our drinking water, in our wells, that's something that should be requiring all of our attention and making sure that we're putting enough resources to say things that happened in the past, landfills that happened in the past, we're going to clean them up and we're going to spend the correct amount of money to do that well. And that's going to take a strong EPA that's able to come in and say and be able to put the money where their talk is around this.
Let's talk gun policy a little bit. Do you yourself own any firearms?
I do not own a firearm, Adam.
That being said, what would you do to try and stop school shootings?
So, this is incredibly tough, and I remember, so we were watching Moana, as we are every night at our house, but on the night of Parkland happening, I remember turning on the TV, and just for a second, the coverage came up of Parkland as I was trying to get over to Netflix, and I thought to myself, this is unbelievable that I don't want my daughter to see this. I don't want to talk about this. I don't want her even seeing this as 1.5 years old. But it sunk in then that in 3.5 years, regardless of how well I can protect her, she's going to have to go to the same elementary school that I did. And she's going to learn, you know, certainly where the macaroni necklaces are, where the finger paints are, but also where to hide in case of an active shooter. And I promised myself then that I would do everything in my power to have that conversation with her, but also say, these are all the things that we stepped up and did in the wake of this to make that better. And I would support, you know, certainly background checks. I would support a ban on bump stocks and high capacity magazines. And I'd also support a ban on AR-15s, assault style weapons. I know they're not assault weapons because they don't have automatic and burst fire, but we need to get these weapons of war off the streets.
And yet many of those AR-15s have been sold over the last 8 years. What to do about those? The country is awash in guns as it
yeah,
is.
Yeah, I think, you know, we're not going to take those guns away. I don't see that happening. And when you go back to 86 and we banned, you know, the M16 or made it much harder to get, we grandfathered in. That's probably what's going to happen. I would like to see a background check on bullets to make sure that we're able to see somebody that, you know, bought one 10 years ago and now has all these red flag laws coming up, we can understand, you know, maybe that they should be looked into a little bit more.
All right. Daigle McEachern, we'll see you out there on the campaign trail.
Hey, thanks a lot, Adam.
Thanks for your time. We appreciate it.